Morning, God's beloved.
Morning.
It's good to see you all this morning. I'm Reverend Megan Pegler, the senior minister here, and welcome to worship with University Christian Church. If you would sign in, we would love to have a record of your attendance. There's a QR code on the back of your bulletin where you can sign in online. If you need a restroom at any point during the service, this side door right over here will lead you to where you need to go. I have a few announcements. First, I'd like to thank again Ron for his going above and beyond to help us get set up down here with the AV. You may have noticed the extra work he did with the cameras this week. There was some shaking last week, and look at it now. We are set. So thank you, Ron. Next week, 1 week from today, on June 9th, we are going to have a snack and serve. Now, through 3 weeks in June, starting on that evening, we are going to be hosting groups from Be the Neighbor. We've done that before. Be the Neighbor, was the result of Connect Ministries and Reach Beyond Mission merging together a couple years ago. So last year we hosted Be the Neighbor. The year before that, we hosted Reach Beyond Mission for many years in a row. We have our groups coming from Ohio and I think the North Carolina. I know the name of the church, but not necessarily exactly where they're coming from. And then Dallas and Arlington. And so it's going to be busy around here all through June. And so what we are going to do as a congregation to welcome all of these visitors, ranging from middle school through high school and then all of their adult sponsors, we're going to write them messages of welcome and inspiration. So making some little cards, that's going to be our service project next week, so that we can help them to feel welcome. We're going to do this project in the Norden Lounge, which is where they will be kind of centrally located during their time with us. And there will be snacks galore. So snack and serve with us next Sunday. You won't want to miss out on helping all of these service learning groups feel welcomed here at UCC. Also, I want to welcome Leaf, who started singing with us last week. Leaf just graduated from UT a couple weeks ago. Yeah, a few weeks ago. So we're so glad that they're singing with us this summer. Welcome. Welcome to UCC. Yeah, let's give a round of applause. Speaking of choir, Morgan is out for the summer as usual, and so thank you to Sabrina for taking on the leadership this summer. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention that we are now in Pride Month. And so we are not having like a special sermon series or anything about Pride, but we are going to, as always, live into our wide, expansive welcome and celebration of all of God's children, and especially this month, our LGBTQIA+ sisters and brothers and siblings. So wear your Pride earrings, do whatever you want to this month as we celebrate and rejoice in God's image reflected in our LGBTQIA siblings. And now, dear ones, peace to you and welcome to this time of worship. Thank you. Our call to worship this morning is a selection from Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I raise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. I try to count them. They are more than the sand. I come to the end. I am still with you. Let us sing with joy to the one who searches and knows us. And before we sing, we are going to pass the peace of Christ. We are still a little bit new to this practice. We usually only do it once or twice a year. And so I would like to remind you, not everyone is comfortable with hugs. So if you want to hug, please get consent before you do so. Otherwise, hand on the chest in a nod or a bow, a smile, a simple peace. A handshake is most of the time okay. Just make sure that you're getting, everyone comfortable with what we are doing. I saw Charlotte do a high five. High five would be fine too. Yeah. I don't think we'll go to the elbow bump like we did 4 years ago. Fist bump maybe would be good, yeah. So, the peace of Christ be with you.
Thank you. John Wesley told the early Methodists to sing with gusto better than the people in pubs sang the songs of Satan, and I certainly think we sang with gusto this morning. If you'll join me in our litany of praise. God's love shines in our hearts.
To the acknowledge the glory of God.
Siblings, praise the Lord.
God's name be praised.
Next, if you will turn to the back of the bulletin, we have our prayer concerns. We want to celebrate that Sean joined us last week and to continue to pray as Wayne recovers through another round of chemo. So for our pastoral prayer, when I say, O God, in your mercy, you will respond with, hear our prayer. So the Lord be with you. There is no holy one like the Lord, no one besides you. There is no rock like our God. Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. God who calls us by name, we have not always lived up to your voice and your love, yet our hearts rejoice in the Lord. We delight in your deliverance. Mighty and merciful one, we pray for Sean, that Sean would experience beloved community, and for those in our bulletin, we remind and bring up to you that everyone would experience the love of your church. O God, in your mercy, there is no place where we could go where you are not already there. Help us see glimpses of you in war zones and rubble, in hospital wards and halls of trouble. O God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray you raise up the poor from the dust that all might inherit a seat of honor. We pray for the forlorn and the weary, that you might bring all life. O God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy One, let us talk no more with arrogance, but humbly let our lives reflect Jesus Christ, the light of the world, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
let us listen now for what the Spirit is saying to the church. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli, and the word of the Lord was rare in those days, and visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was laying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel, "Samuel, Samuel," and he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call you. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel, Samuel," and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call you, son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. Then the Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there before him, calling, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." May God bless the reading and the hearing of these ancient and holy words.
Will you pray with me? Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So we are in the first Sunday of ordinary time. The color of this season is green. It's the color of growing things. The Salt Project writes that the church alternates between holy seasons of Advent, Epiphany, Lent, Eastertide, and then everyday life. And so we're going back and forth between the joys of celebration and the grunt work of growth. There's an invitation inherent in ordinary time, and that is for us to grow, to learn, to deepen and refresh our discipleship. It might seem ordinary, but it's anything but, because we are able to delve a little bit deeper into how it is to follow Christ every day. We're starting a new series today called God at Work, and through this series we're going to look at the lives of Samuel and David and see God's gracious actions through their lives and see how God called them and also calls us, how God responded to them and responds to us, how God saw them and sees us, how God leads us and saves us and unites us. I want to go back just a little bit in 1 Samuel. We picked it up at the beginning of chapter 3, but there is Hannah's prayer from chapter 2. And it serves as sort of a theological prologue to everything that happens in 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings. If you have read Hannah's prayer before, you know that it reminds us of Mary's Magnificat. There are those echoes that are so obvious. And so we hear in these prayers reversals of fortune, and that the poor and the lowly are lifted up, and that the disobedient are provoked to repent and return to God's ways. So that is the undercurrent to where we are today with this story about Samuel. This is one of the many call stories in the Bible. We are familiar with many of those from Scripture, but also you've probably heard call stories from your ministers over the years, and other calls that people have experienced to some sort of vocation that they are living out with their lives. But call stories go beyond those big stories. We are called day to day to live and to love in Jesus' name. Samuel heard God's call, and we hear that he didn't understand that it was God at first. Has that ever happened to you? Some sort of a call that you're sensing, you're not sure where it's coming from, you're not sure exactly what the call is in the first place. It's hard sometimes for us to discern what and who is calling us. There is so much noise in the world. We've got all of the outside chatter, but then also what's going on in our own minds and hearts. Lots of swirls of opinions and desires and regrets and fears and uncertainties and timelines and plans. All of that is swirling around as we are trying to hear the voice of God. And so sometimes we need help when we are discerning God's voice amidst all of that noise. One place that we get help is through mentors and guides. Now, there are plenty of people out there who want to be mentors and guides who should never be anyone's mentors or guides. We have to sift through the cacophony because not all of those wannabe mentors actually could guide us toward wisdom. But there are plenty of partners on the journey who can help us to hear God's call. People who ground themselves in grace and compassion and love and justice. There's a Presbyterian pastor, Mihi Kim Court, who tells about how she was going to be a pediatrician. That was her plan all of her growing up years. She got into college, started on those science and math classes, and was failing those science and math classes. Her plan didn't seem to be coming into fruition the way she thought it would. And she found herself loving the English and philosophy and religion and history classes. And so she sensed that she was being drawn in some other direction. She still didn't know what that would look like, but she was listening, she was paying attention. And at the same time, her father was enrolled in some classes at seminary. I believe it was Yale. And so this is a mainline seminary where there were lots of different types of students. And he had lots of women classmates too. And this was at a time when she just had not seen that many women in ministry. She was not yet in the Presbyterian church that she came to be in, but he helped her by telling her about his classes and his classmates. He helped her to see that women could be leaders in the church, even in the Korean church, which was where they found themselves at that time. She went on to become a pastor and writer and speaker. And none of that would have happened if she hadn't listened to the guidance of her father, who was listening to the voice of God himself. Samuel had Eli, who helped him to realize the voice of God that was calling him. And Mihi Kim Court points out that Samuel was already listening. We kind of laugh a little bit at that, how he took so long to realize that it was God, kept going back to Eli. But he was listening and responding to God, even though he didn't realize that it was God he was hearing. He was attentive to those who were around him, his mentors and guides, and that made a difference. There's another way, another tool in our discernment toolkit, and that is paying attention. Did you notice that when Eli realized it was God who was calling Samuel, he told Samuel, go lie down. Go back to bed. And listen. He didn't tell Samuel to go do something to bring about God's voice. Just go and be ready. Listen for it. Attend to the voice of God when it comes. We have to be receptive. As Howard Thurman, the theologian, wrote, we have to listen for the voice of the genuine that is deep within. So it is good for us to follow the advice and guidance of others, but we have to be open ourselves to hearing God's voice. Now that can look like a lot of different things. We could go lie down, take a nap. We could just slow down. We could stare at something beautiful, listen to some music. Let ourselves not get some things done so that there is some space that opens up for us to hear. If we don't create that kind of space for new ideas and insights and possibilities and calls, how will they make themselves known? We have to stay open to the idea that there are and will be new and unexpected words and calls from God. We often get into ruts where we are doing the same thing we've always been doing. It's always worked well like this, so why don't we keep doing that? Meanwhile, we are dulling ourselves to hearing God's call. We are shutting it out because we are so attached to things as they have been. Mary Oliver's poetry is all about paying attention and listening. And her poem, Praying, I think, has something to teach us. It doesn't have to be the blue iris. It could be the weeds in a vacant lot or a few small stones. Just pay attention. Then patch a few words together and don't try to make them elaborate. This isn't a contest, but a doorway into thanks and a silence in which another voice may speak. Do we offer those silences? If we do, if we are able to achieve that, how do we know that it's the voice of God that we hear? This is another step in our discernment process. So if you are thinking that you are feeling some sort of a call to maybe a new activity or behavior or way of being in relationship with someone, you can pay attention to how that concept makes you feel. Is it giving you energy or is it making you feel drained? Is it drawing you into more community or is it going to lead to isolation? Is it leaving you feeling inspired or hopeless? Is it giving you a sense of peace or anxiety? We might not always feel totally comfortable though with what the call is. And so, it's not as easy as, do I feel peaceful or anxious about this? Because whatever God is calling us to could very well be the right thing, but we are still feeling anxious about it. And so we have to pay attention, again, to the big picture. Is this anxiety something I need to sit with and live with and work through? So that I'm able to follow the call of God? Is God nudging me in this direction even though I don't really want to go? There are plenty of stories in the Bible like that, right? And in our own lives. Just recently, we have seen examples of university students calling our attention to the need for peace in Gaza. Calling us to ceasefire. A lot of people have found themselves uncomfortable with that, uncomfortable with that approach, but also with the call for ceasefire in general. And so, is that discomfort something that we should continue to lift up, or is it something we should examine and wonder, what is it about this whole situation I might be able to attend to in a new way? What is the voice of God calling us to? Maybe it's okay to just be uncomfortable for a little while. Maybe we lift up our voices and join with the students and call for a ceasefire and a return of the hostages. We are not taking sides because everyone loves to take sides. It is our human inherent kind of way of being. We love to have a team. Those of you who are into sports, that's not me, but those of you who are into sports, you know how that feels. You are rooting for your team. And we find ourselves aligning with various groups and countries and factions, and that is not the way of God. Every single person on this earth is beloved by God, whether we like it or not. And so what can we do to lift up and help to bring thriving and abundance of life all over the whole earth? About 10 years ago, Glennon Doyle, who many of you have read her books and listened to her podcasts, she had, and maybe still has, a nonprofit called Together Rising. And they break it up to Get Her Rising. And it would often benefit women who were in some sort of need. And they would have these things called the Love Flash Mob. And they would receive applications from people who were nominating women and girls who'd been going through some sort of hardship or tragedy. And then they channeled that pain into service and outreach for others. And so sometimes these nominations had to do with helping, like whatever new effort they were working toward to help others. Sometimes it was like, send so-and-so on a vacation because they've been bending over backwards serving all of the people around them for so long and haven't had a break in 10 years. Sometimes it was, let's get this little girl a bicycle. Like the needs were just all over the place. And they had done these love flash mobs before. And this time, they were going about it the same way. They receive the nominations, and then they narrow it down to these, you know, particular worthy nominees, and then they put it out to everyone, and the whole community that follows them on social media and emails and everything, they contribute, and then these wishes are fulfilled. And so one day, the board chair called to tell Glennon about the board's decision to, get along further in this process of the love flash mob. So Glennon says, have we narrowed down the pool? And the board member said, yes, we have 176 nominees. And Glennon's jaw dropped a little. And she said, well, how many did we start with? 176. The board thought they were all worthy and could not imagine cutting any of them. And so Glennon, in a blog post about this whole thing, says that she felt panicked immediately, and then she heard this verse rising above the panic. This verse from Luke 6, give to all who ask of you. Give to all who ask of you. She heard that rising up, and then she writes, my brain kicked in and patted that sweet thought on the head and said to it with a patronizing smile, well, aren't you precious, little verse? That's impossible. Give to everyone? Ha! Sit down, you ridiculous, audacious verse. That is sometimes how we respond to the call of God. And then she writes, and then I heard from God. For me, hearing from God is really just like hearing an internal voice that's a little calmer, braver, truer, more certain than my typical incessant inner chatter. And she said, that voice told her, yes, choose them all. Everybody's in, baby. Everyone was going to be seen and loved through this love flash mob. And so they worked and worked toward that day. And then that morning she prayed to God, okay, I showed up, your turn. Love you, good luck. And God did show up, and through the generosity of the people following that love flash mob, they raised nearly $300,000 and were able to fulfill all of the wishes. God calls us, each of us, all of us, individually and as beloved community. God calls us to love. It's not always easy to follow that call or to hear God's voice. But when we do, that call invites a response to give and to serve and to celebrate and to delight, to be the body of Christ. So I invite you today, what is it? What new thing is God calling you to do? Let us each help each other hear the call. And let us listen ourselves to that voice too. And so as we are practicing together that process of listening, I invite you to close your eyes, open your palms, breathe in and breathe out. God is calling you. Let us respond by saying, speak, for your servant is listening. Speak, for your servant is listening. Speak, for your servant is listening.
We now come to the part of the service here called the invitation to offering. That's a term that you use in this congregation that I really appreciate, an invitation to offering. In my denominational tradition, we often just say the invitory or the call to the invitory. But as my friend Carrie Headington Boren, a soap opera stars turned Episcopal evangelist and lay theologian, says, all of the Christian life is one invitation after another, constantly inviting people to a feast that is out of this world. So as we come to this time of offerings, this is again your invitation to give of your time, your talents, and your skills, and of course, of your money. When you are invited and you respond to that call, that seed that you plant of your gifts, however they are given, don't just stay here. They extend over and over again. Your generosity allows Labyrinth to invite students into a call to hear the voice of God. To hear Jesus say, I love you. Your invitation to generosity allows me to be present in students' lives even when it means answering texts at midnight of students studying abroad in Germany trying to figure out how to get back to from Vienna back to Munich. That happened last night, by the way. And I had no real help to offer besides my prayers. But that beautiful invitation of offering of ourselves never is wasted. It feeds our neighbors. It offers love to people who are alone. We've just watched in the last few weeks of the protests where your generosity to Labyrinth then, which was turned into rice and beans and food, then went to the basement of University Baptist where a little Palestinian woman and her son cooked pots of soup that not only fed protesters, but also their homeless neighbors and anyone who came to the door and asked. And that generosity extended again and again. So let us give as you come to communion, either putting your offering in the plates or giving online, and give of your lives, your time, and your talents so that together we may continue to invite people to the feast that is out of this world. Amen.
I have heard your Christ's bread I will provide, till the hurt be satisfied. I will give my life to them, whom shall I send? Here I am.
Compassionate God, we trust that you hear our cries when we feel helpless and hopeless. When we listen and put our trust in you, we know that you are with us to offer comfort and to ease the weight of our burdens. Persistent God, challenge us to listen when you call us to your service. Help us to answer your call to love and to serve and to heal. Help us to hear the shouts of the hungry and to answer with food and nourishment. Help us to hear the cries of those in pain and to answer with comfort and healing. Help us to hear the sobs of the lost and to answer with your welcoming love. May our gifts today answer the cries of those in need in our world, offering ease and hope. May we humbly act as your servants and as Christ's hands and feet in the world. Amen.
Thank you.
am so grateful for a hymn that invites us to the table. And if you've been listening today, you've heard invitations, you've heard calls. And they are to being in the presence of the Lord. We hear of Moses who took off his sandals. We hear of David who danced. We heard of Hannah who prayed today. And so we come to the Lord with different responses. But today you've heard the call to come to this table. And as a church, I want us to join in this time of reflection to say, God speak, your servant is listening. So Christ gave the church this example, and so now we remember the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took the bread that he had been given and gave thanks, and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." According to his commandment,
we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming glory.
Can you pray with me? God of all creation, we thank you for your presence at this communion table. Bless this bread and cup, and please bless us, that we may share these emblems of communion in the presence of Jesus our Savior. Take us from this table refreshed, rested, and ready to serve in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
So as we prepare for communion, there's little cups with bread and little cups with juice. So you'll come forward and take communion from the elders, and you'll go ahead and take both the bread and the cup while we're in the fellowship hall, since there's no place, you know, behind the pews to put the cups. But come to the table. All are welcome here. So when you are ready, please come down the front aisle. Thank you.
If you are interested in joining in with the church in formal membership today, or if you'd like to proclaim for the first time Jesus is the Christ, or if you have heard a call today and would like to share that with the congregation, I invite you to come forward as we stand and sing our closing hymn together. Snack and serve in 1 week from today. Those cards of encouragement and inspiration will go not only to Be the Neighbor participants, but any that we have left over, we're going to add to our blessing bags. So come and share the love. There are many ways to hear the call of God and to respond to it today and all of this week. So listen, help each other to listen. And beloved, as you go from here, may you rejoice in the immeasurable love of God fully revealed in the face of Jesus. Go in God's goodness, grace, and peace to love and serve. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Kathy.
George Frisbee, by the way.
I like that.
Hey, he's up.
Yeah.